is the chair. She has recused herself from this particular matter. I'll be acting as the voting chair this evening. The first item of business on the agenda is the minutes of the previous meeting of September the 15th, 1992, which were in our packets. Does anybody have any corrections or comments on those minutes?
I move they are accepted as written.
Second.
All in favor? Fair enough. Thank you very much. Judy Gardner, I'd like to appoint you as a voting member for this evening. Thank you. The next item, in fact, the only item on the agenda this evening, is the Gramsci Wetlands Alteration Permit. This is a request by Dr. Reed Gramsci and his neighbors for an after-the-fact wetlands alteration permit for installation of underground utilities and an access road in the vicinity of Sunrise Drive and Cunner Lane. We are going to have a public hearing this evening. If there's anybody from the public that would like to speak, could I just have a show of hands at this point if there's anyone who would like to speak from the public? Very well. Okay. Let's continue with it then. Dr. Gramsci, would you like to make a very short introductory statement about what this is all about? And then we'll go right into the public hearing.
Good evening. I think the board is probably tired of hearing my introductory statements. They've been famous before. I could certainly summarize the reasons for the project and things like that if you would like.
Why not? I think what we'd like to do is have you summarize, particularly for the people who are members of the public who might be interested in speaking hereafter. And please do keep it brief.
Five families that live in the area of Hanford Cove have been inconvenienced and bothered by utility wires. These are the original utility wires in this area. It's an area exposed to high winds, and frequently the wires are down, our phones are inoperative, and we lose our utility service. In response to this, we have been working for a number of years in an effort to bury the wires, to improve our sight lines, and to improve our utility service. Through various considerations over the years of various options on ways to do this, we worked with CMP and the cable and the phone company and came up with a plan to do this. This was expedited by a short on one of the telephone poles that caused a fire in an area which was inaccessible to the town fire department. The project was reviewed with the CMP and the phone company and the cable company and the five families that are involved in this project, and work commenced in June to dig a trench for burying the cable. It was unbeknownst to us that the trench went through a wetlands area. Work was stopped, and in the ensuing months we have been in the process of our application procedure to satisfy the town requirements for burying the cable, basically. To summarize our project involves putting in two new phone poles or removing 14 phone poles and burying utility wires for a distance of approximately 500 feet. We have endeavored to do this in a timely fashion. It's getting short in the growing season, and it's our hope and wish that this can proceed on. There are several issues that have been raised, and I'm not sure if this is the appropriate time to address those issues by the memorandum that I've just received this evening. And I don't know whether you'd like to talk about these first or hear what I would have to say regarding these issues.
Dr. Gramsci, I guess my preference, unless the board has another suggestion, would be to proceed directly from here to the public hearing and let the board hear what members of the public have to say, and then we'll be discussing the matter before the board, at which time you'll have certainly another chance to describe your response to the particular issues. Okay. Thank you. At this point, I'd like to open the public hearing to members of the public who'd like to speak. If you would like to speak, please come forward to the microphone, identify yourself, and state your case.
Good evening. My name is Jack Roberts. I'm the chairman of the Cape Elizabeth Conservation Commission. On September 26, 1992, members of the Cape Elizabeth Conservation Commission made a site visit to the project currently under consideration. The purpose of this visit was to review the extent of the wetland disturbance and make an appropriate recommendation to the planning board. It should be noted that this site visit was made without benefit of having a representative from the project present to field questions, despite an attempt to arrange such a meeting with the applicants. Based upon review of technical information submitted to the town in on-site review of the project, the following observations were made. The trench, which has been excavated to the Marshall residence, impacts significant wetland vegetation and represents a clear and blatant violation of the town's wetland ordinance. Alternative locations for the trench were not explored with the town prior to beginning construction. It appears that several alternative alignments were available, which would have either avoided or minimized the extent of wetland impact. While there is no doubt that removal of the overhead lines will benefit the residents' views, it is unclear whether undergrounding will ultimately result in less impact to the wetland areas, as the applicant has stated. The life expectancy, maintenance consideration, and ability to upgrade or add additional capacity to these lines should be clarified by the applicant. Based upon the observations noted above, the Conservation Commission recommends the following. A, the applicant should be required to submit a full mitigation plan to the town describing complete restoration of all disturbed areas. This plan should be prepared by a qualified professional and address such items as filling procedures, reestablishment of all natural vegetation, erosion controls, and long-term maintenance requirements. The objective of the Conservation Commission is the reestablishment of vegetation to pre-impact conditions by planting appropriate shrub and wetland plant materials. This plan should be approved by the town's tree warden and Cumberland County Soil and Conservation Service. B, all filling materials which was used to construct the access road should be completely removed and all disturbed areas appropriately revegetated. And C, the applicant should submit documentation of land capacity, life expectancy, and maintenance considerations for review. If future disturbance of the utility trench is anticipated for any reason, we recommend that an alternative trench location should be required at this time, in addition to restoration of the existing impacted area.
Thank you, Jack. Anybody else wish to speak? Elizabeth?
My name is Elizabeth Peterson, and I am a resident of Hannaford Cove. However, this area is across the cove from me. But I would like to read this letter, which I had written since I didn't expect to be here this evening, to the members of the planning board. This is my expression of approval for the Gramsci Wetlands proposal. The people involved are conscientious residents of Hannaford Cove who will faithfully restore to its natural state any land disturbed by placing wires, etc., underground. I wholeheartedly endorse moving the telephone poles, both for aesthetic and safety reasons. We receive the full brunt of easterly and northeasterly storms, which conceivably could fall poles toward private property. I understand that they are in need of replacement, and moving them in back of dwellings would certainly be a wise safety measure. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else from the public like to have a chance to speak at this point? Yes. Yes, would you come to the microphone, please, and identify yourself, and let us hear what you have to say.
My name is William Simons, and I do live in Hannaford Cove also. Unfortunately for me, I live on the other side of the cove from the Gramsci group, and we're all ledge over there, but we would love to have our wires underground, too, if possible, because we're experiencing the same problems that they are with poor telephone reception, and we have outages from our power on occasion. I also, I had another thought there.
Take a minute, it might come to
you. I think the road that goes back to the poles is there so that utilities can get into it if need be. Yeah, and so I think it's important to keep that small section there. And I also understand that at one time, on the poles that exist now, not too long ago, they had one of the electrical transformers catch fire, and it was quite a hazardous thing, and I think for that reason they're starting to replace some poles along Hannaford Cove Road itself. And I just wish to speak in support of this whole project.
Thank you, Mr. Simonson. Anyone else from the public who'd like a chance to speak? Yes, please.
My name is Patricia Snow, and I am also a resident of Hannaford Cove. It's been brought up by the chairman of the Conservation Commission about regrowth.
Excuse me, Ms. Snow, you're one of the applicants, are you?
I am.
Fine.
Am I allowed to speak?
Absolutely. I just wanted to make sure that I was, that you were that Ms. Snow.
I can appreciate their concern. I think that my family and all of the families out there have been concerned with Hannaford Cove for 40 and 50 years. We have managed to maintain probably one of the only areas in Cape Elizabeth that is relatively unchanged from 1929 until the present. And as such, we are very concerned with our stewardship of that area. Last October, when we had the fire that everyone is talking about on the pole, we also had our road washout. And you people who have been out there are familiar with the pond, and all winter and much of the spring, it was full of sand, and one would wonder what was going to happen to it. And nature, being a very restorative source, completely revegetated it in its natural way that it had been prior to that. And I have no doubt that the area that's under discussion will also revegetate itself as this area has. We don't have any desire to change anything. Our desire has always been to maintain the area, and we've pursued this because we receive inferior service with telephones. We receive oftentimes inferior service with electricity. And as far as the road width, I think that's been discussed as the access road, and there would be some material coming out of that. However, there has to be some way for emergency services to be able to get into this area that was very evident to us last year as we stood and watched the fire department and Central Maine Power trying to access these utility poles, or this particular utility pole, with great difficulty. And if that area had ever caught fire because they couldn't deal with it, the damage to that wetlands would have been far superior to anything that we might consider doing. And for all of those reasons, I obviously am in favor, and thank you for your time.
Thank you. Anyone else from the public wish to speak? Going once, going twice?
I just wanted to note that Hugh Farrington, who's an abutter, did call me and will not be attending the meeting this evening, but did want to note that he was supportive of the Sunrise Drive plan, that he wanted to see all of the fill removed from that area. He was concerned that he felt that the natural vegetation would take over, and he was supportive of filling in the ditches that have been dug. So since he did call me, I wanted to make sure his comments were on the record.
Thank you very much. Any other comments from the public? Okay, at this time I will close the public hearing and ask the members of the board if anyone has anything particular to discuss or to ask of the applicant. Tom?
Yes, there was, I think the applicant said that there were several issues that he wished to discuss in addition to your previous presentation. If you would just bring those up now.
What I would do, Mr. Emery, is just I've received the same memorandum that you have, and I would just, I think some of these things are things that we've discussed before, but again, I would just like to state why we've done things the way we've done and the reasons for that.
Dr. Ramsey, are you going to be referring to the memo dated
yes.
September the 29th?
That's correct.
Fine.
I'll just go start right from the top and go right through here. Number one is the site plan. It was my understanding from the last meeting that the a survey that was done met the board's requirement for the survey. In addition to that, there's always this been a question of a right-of-way, and what I was able to do was go back through the Cumberland County deeds and find a deed that you've all received a copy of that is referred to in the FSMRS deed. And basically what this does is say that the FSMRS have right-of-way to Sunrise Drive. That was a question that we had, and it wasn't defined clearly, and I hope that the deed that you have in your packet has answered that question. So to answer number one, it was my understanding that the site plan that had been submitted, and this was prepared by a surveyor, he had the letter from the town as to what the town requested in the survey, and he had communicated with the town before he did his work. There was a question as to meets and bounds, and it was my understanding that if we proved that we had the right-of-way, that the absolute establishment of the meets and bounds was not necessary. Issue number three. In our discussions with CMP and with the contractor that's doing the work, we have discussed the conduit issue. According to CMP, and their representative said that they were going to be here this evening, I don't see him here. In discussions with the cable and the phone company at CMP, they tell me that bearing cable is a common everyday occurrence, and I have asked them, what are the chances of this cable needing maintenance, needing upgrading? And they have told me that that is a most unlikely eventuality. In our planning to do this, we talked with the contractor about the price of putting the cable in conduit, and the price to do that increases our family's cost by many thousands of dollars. When we weigh the potential benefit of a conduit versus the potential cost, we have elected not to do that in an effort to save ourselves several thousands of dollars, and understanding the fact that it is most unlikely that this cable will ever require attention. On number four, the mitigation plan, there have been several, we have submitted a plan by a soil scientist, Mr. Albert Frick. This plan has been approved by the Cumberland County Soils District. I thought that we had, we have shown this and given a copy of this mitigation plan to our contractor who is performing the work, and he understands the specifics that are, have been requested and that you have reviewed. I sincerely hope that we have satisfied the town's requirement. I would just add in passing that I think we're all dismayed at what has come to pass and what we perhaps naively had assumed would be a relatively small project. It has dragged on. Our expenses have perhaps at this point in establishing and in providing the documentation required for the town, including the survey, the soils and conservation report, the soil scientist report, the DEP permits, we have generated many thousands of dollars of expenses on, and basically doing what our initial plan was to start with. That's all I have to say.
Questions from the board?
I guess the only question I have, I really think if the cable is to be direct burial, I think it's to everyone's benefit to know where it is. You have a typical cross section, but once it's buried and the area is revegetated, if there's ever any need for maintenance, I'm just thinking of a situation where you might have another type of cable coming in. We don't know what's going to happen with electronics over the next 10 years. At least you will know where it is. And there's two ways of doing that. One is not, other than the survey that you have here, which only gives elevations, the other way is to simply put it in a conduit and then you don't care where it is. Short of not putting it into a conduit, the other thing would be to go out and as you relay the trench is to put markers in on a regular basis, perhaps a 50 or 100 foot interval. So at least there are some points where you know along that cable trench where the cable has been laid for future reference.
I addressed this question with Mr. Story of the CMP, asking that same question. I said, and this was in my own mind, I was asking, the town has asked for the survey, which we've done, and I was asking CMP, I said, you know, why did this have to come from the town? Why doesn't CMP require this so that they can have access to the wires and know where they are? And CMP's response is that we never ask for a survey because we have sophisticated metal detection equipment that allows us to locate the cable. So I was unaware of that, but that's how they have said that surveys and things like that are not useful for them in the field, and they have metal detection equipment that they use when they need to.
It's probably easier for them to use a medical metal detection than it is to hire a surveyor.
Okay.
All of this will be on private property. The trench essentially is all on private property. Is that correct?
Yes. The only part is the part that goes under the road.
Mm-hmm. But once we're
that,
away
and
from
that is
the
private
road,
property. Yes. That
yeah.
is yes.
And that trench is only serving that one property. That's not a loop that goes into the property and feeds back out and continues the electrical power to the other homes.
That is correct. Where the access road was, there was the new telephone pole right by the border of the Farrington property. Mm-hmm. And if you recall, there's the trench, and then there's a short section, and then there's a trench going to the Fismer home. So in one section of the trench that's away from the water, there are two sources of electrical service. One going in that trench and then branching off to the Fismer house, home, and then the other wires going directly to the Marshall Monk's home on the end of the point.
And the one going to the Monk's home is dead-ended at that home.
That's
that
correct.
Doesn't have anything to do with, once it's on their property, it's a dead-end situation.
That's correct.
Okay. Do you have any comments on the latest comments regarding mulching and netting of the seeded area? Do you have any problems with that?
We asked Mr. Murray, the contractor who's done the work, was out there with us for discussion with the families involved and with the Farringtons, and we've reviewed the plan with him, and he was to proceed as is outlined with mulching in that area. It is his feeling, as I think is all of ours in the neighborhood, and if you look at the area since the trench has been dug, there's brush and growth in the piles of dirt that have been dug for the trench. It's our feeling that in this area, it's an overgrown area, and to quote Mr. Frick, the soil scientist, there's nothing you can do to prevent growth in that area. We're confident that it will return to its natural state very quickly.
Yeah, I wouldn't disagree with that. I think the only issue is, since it's in a wetland area, that the purpose of the planting is to stop the immediate erosion so that it has a chance to regenerate itself. I have no other questions.
Any other comments from board members? Mr. Edsel?
I'll just say that just general comment that I think the applicants understand they're a pretty clear and blatant violation of wetlands alteration. Basically, they've already said so, and they've said they're sorry. They also understand that it's wetlands alteration is serious stuff. We take it seriously. A lot of people do. I'm concerned for two things. Number one, that the process that we're going through here does not become so onerous for applicants that it future applicants continue to scheme to go around that. That's not the intent. The process should be one that the people look for both mutual and some municipal benefit from to preserve wetlands. I think the applicants now see that. They see how serious the situation is. I think our order really is to try to reestablish the impact of wetlands as quickly as we can. That was the purpose of this evening's meeting, to try to get that underway. I don't benefit, or I lack the benefit of having visited the site, so technical questions, I will leave to other board members. That's all I have to say.
Comments from other board members, if any? Ms. Lardner?
In some ways, I feel this is awkward to say without crediting you with some behavior I don't think you did, but I feel as one board member that we're being held hostage because we have a bad environmental situation there that should be corrected. If you were coming to me before you did it, I don't think you would have my vote for how it is unless I were convinced that there was absolutely no alternatives. So as one board member, I definitely favor the conduit because I am not convinced, as Mr. Emery said, that there will not be needs for future kinds of wiring or home offices that require special computer cables and so on. Mr. Roberts suggested that we might alternatively consider that you could not do any more work in that. You'd have to look at alternative trenches and so forth, and I think in the long term a conduit might make much more economic sense than going in and perhaps doing blasting or what have you. I also would have to rely on Mr. Kudlitz from the Soil and Water Conservation District. If he indicates that it should be seeded, I would trust him, I think, more than any of us here, and I understand your point that it will revegetate, and a lot of places will revegetate, but there often can be erosion in the meantime. Personally, as this member, I don't see any reason to hold this up, but it's a very awkward situation for the board, trying to balance not hurting the wetlands anymore and not hurting new homeowners down there, but since the process is so backwards, it's just very awkward, and I personally would favor some of the recommendations that Mr. Roberts mentioned as conditions of the approval. And one more question, I guess, to our planner. It still is not even clear to me the ownership of some of these places. I think that was the intent of the board asking for a more meets and bounds descriptions. Looking at the deed that purportedly gives rights to Sunrise Drive, it's not even clear to me that that is Sunrise Drive because I'm not looking at a plan. Have you verified that, Maureen?
I can't.
You can't.
It's
see,
not clear.
It's very awkward for us, and I understand your position, but it's difficult for us. If it was someone else's property and you were the property owner, you might appreciate the fact that we're trying to be very cautious about how we proceed.
I can understand that. In the description of the deed that I've given you, it's not even labeled Sunrise Drive. It's termed the road, and it describes the direction. That right away was granted apparently before the road was named.
Typically, the board would have a plan that we could just match the meets and bounds, and we would understand that that's it. It's just very difficult for us to deal with this, given the information we have and the timing.
The only comment that I could make in retrospect on that is that the plan was developed. Hindsight is always a lot more clear, but the plan was developed by a surveyor in communication with, he talked to the town officials before he did that. He had the letter with the specifics of what was requested from him. Apparently that wasn't clear to him that that was one of the requests.
Dr. Ramsey, I guess I'd like to add my 2 cents worth here, and that is, with all due respect, I think you have done put out a tremendous amount of effort as a layperson in trying to meet the requirements of the board. I'm disturbed, however, that the board is being asked to determine something where we really don't know what we're doing on the property ownership issue. As I think you know, there was an abutter or a neighbor of some kind who was present at the site walk that the board took in July, who indicated that he might have some rights over the road. Now, I was wondering whether he was going to show up this evening. I would like to report for the record that that person did not show up, nor did anybody claim to have any particular rights of way. I'm a lawyer. I'm not particularly a real estate title lawyer, but my understanding of the law is that a right of way granted in a deed, and whether or not this is the right deed and where it shows up on the site plan, I don't know because the surveyor hasn't told us. Even if that's true, a right of way does not grant the right to install utilities. Now, with that said, we are faced with the situation that this miner indicates, which is we've got an open trench, and we are concerned about trying to do what we can to the circumstances to move the thing along. I don't usually have much trouble being understood, and I thought we were very clear the last time that we needed more information on the site plan. If that didn't get communicated, I don't know why not. But I was underwhelmed when I got the package because I was expecting to see an awful lot more. However, with respect to what needs to be done, I guess I come down as one board member on trying to ask that we have some kind of indication about what will the mitigation plan be. I think I, in particular, would probably be in favor of a performance guarantee just to make sure it gets done, although I know that vegetation in that area does do very well. But I just don't want to have any difficulties in having this come back, so I think I'd like to have us be very clear about what we're interested in seeing done and then putting the mechanisms in place to have that happen. Anybody else got any comments?
Just one very brief one. I, too, think it's very necessary that conduit be used in the wetland areas for the wires to run through. And I think almost it might make more sense to have conduit throughout the whole area so it would prevent if any wetlands creep or whatever they may do grow, that we'd have that eventuality covered if that did happen.
My only response would that be is that, you know, what you're asking us for is for thousands of dollars. And CMP has said to us that this is how they routinely bury wires. This is what's done all over the state. And no other town or state have they had the requirement to be put in the conduit. There are times when it's done for convenience and other reasons, but CMP has assured me that this is a standard procedure, and an effort to save ourselves thousands of dollars, this is the path that we think is very realistic. Again, just to reiterate what Pat Snow said, these are our lawns. This is where we live. We have no goal to destroy this area. This was the whole plan. Everything else was done in an effort to do this, to restore it to natural beauty and not to have any scars on the land. And we would be just as disappointed or more so than any members of the board if there anything else needs to be done that is going to disrupt this area.
Mr. Edsel.
I, as one board member, I would urge the other board members here not to require conduit. I can't conceive of any benefit that conduit, whether economical or not, that conduit brings to it. It is common practice to bury power cable, utility cable. Conduit is typically used under traveled portions. If it is a case of future technological change where cables would be changed for residential use, my experience with virtually hundreds of commercial sites, there's absolutely no guarantee that if there's a technological change that the same change wouldn't require the change in conduit. I just, one board member, I can't see and would not vote in favor of requiring conduit to be placed in the wetlands area.
Ms.
Larder?
Well, I was just going to ask, I guess, Mr. Emery, then as one board member, if this were to come back before me and someone wanted to dig it up again, I might vote no.
I think the sole benefit of the conduit lies in the fact that it could be sized enough where there could be spare conduit put in the ground that would allow you to feed wires in the future or pull wires. And conceivably, you'd need an intermediate point. I don't know how long this run is, but an intermediate point, that's quite a long distance. But the advantage would be that in the future, you could pull wires or do whatever you need to do without going through the wetland alteration permitting process again, which may be even more stringent at that point, or even perhaps less, but could possibly be more. I would say at this point, I don't disagree with Steve. It's standard practice to direct burial cable all over the place, except for under paved areas. In our experience, we provided spare conduits when we knew there was a possibility of future growth or increase, or what was going to be installed initially was uncertain on the power end, and we just simply had it available. It is more expensive. But I would just simply say that the alternative then would be that if you had to do any maintenance here or replace this cable, it would not be replaced in its current trench, but located outside the resource protection or wetland area, or going back through the same process. And you would be exposed to that risk.
Any further comments from any board members? Anybody want to take a crack at drafting a motion? Be happy to take a small recess if you need some time.
Well, I'll start and
fine.
And,
Mr. Ritz,
might as well get it rolling
here.
I have a motion for the board to consider. Starting with the findings of fact, Dr. Reed Gramsci and neighbors are requesting an after-the-fact wetlands alteration permit for installation of underground utilities and construction of an access road in the area of Connor Lane and Sunrise Drive, which requires review under Section 19-3-9 of the zoning ordinance. The application was deemed complete at the September 15, 1992 Planning Board meeting. A public hearing was held at the September 29, 1992 special meeting of the Planning Board. Proper implementation, proper implementation of the erosion control and wetland revegetation plan requires and will be enhanced by supervision and inspection done by experts with demonstrated knowledge of current techniques. 4, timely and accurate implementation of the plan is required to meet the standards of Section 19-3-9 of the zoning ordinance. Decision, therefore, be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of Reed Gramsci and neighbors for a wetlands alteration permit for installation of underground utilities and construction of an access road in the area of Connor Lane and Sunrise Drive be approved, subject to the following conditions. Number 1, that the applicant shall submit a letter from the Cumberland County Soil and Water Conservation District to the code enforcement officer upon completion work this fall and upon any follow-up deemed necessary by the district next spring. And that's it. End of my motion.
Do I hear a second for that motion? Second by Ms. Lardner. Any further discussion? Mr. Emery?
I'm wondering if we can just put into the motion and for the record that the underground conduit has been waived by the applicant or elected not to be installed by the applicant, and therefore any maintenance of this line requiring the replacement of the line or new line would have to be done either done outside this trench in accordance with the zoning at the time.
Would you like to state that as a second condition to the...
That's a long sentence. But would that be findings of fact or part of the
I think it would be the second condition.
Sure. I would be willing to, in a condensed form, include that. I'm going to restate that.
Because the applicant has elected not to install the conduit, the cable and conduit, that any further maintenance or... additional electrical lines or communication lines shall be located outside the trench in accordance with the appropriate zoning at the time of work.
Ms. Lardner, is that acceptable to you?
I might also ask Mr. Etzel if he would consider a condition requiring that all fill added to Sunrise Drive shall be removed in the manner described in Ross Kudlitz's September 10th, 1992 memo.
I'm sorry, I didn't hear the middle.
That all fill that was placed on Sunrise Drive shall be removed in the manner described in Ross Kudlitz's September 10th, 1992 letter.
Yes.
Just describing how it should be removed.
Right. Ross Kudlitz being from the Cumberland County Soils and Water Conservation District.
Yes.
Is that, okay. Yes.
Ms. Lardner, I guess I'd like to ask, is there anything else in those letters? Might you want to broaden that suggestion to include compliance by the applicant with all of the suggestions made in both of Mr. Cutlitz's letters?
It's hard to work with the motion. My intent would certainly be that all recommendations made by Mr. Cudlitz would be done, including the seeding and the mulching. And we had had some recommendation. It was in the condition that you read that some letter from him be submitted saying that this work was done satisfactorily. I don't know how to get at that. Would you have a suggestion?
It'd be part of the condition number one. I'm just trying to think so that we just don't duplicate what we've already said in the condition, realizing that condition doesn't require approval. It just simply says submit a letter. I'm just trying to think if the letter.
Mr. Edsel, I have a suggestion.
Sure.
If you would permit me to jump in here. Perhaps what we could do is modify the condition, the first condition, to state that the applicant shall comply with the suggestions by the Soil Conservation Service made in their July 29th and September the 10th letters, and that the applicant, that after the completion of the work is done this fall, the applicant will submit a letter from the Cumberland County Soil and Water Basin Conservation District to the court enforcement officer designating that the work has been done, and if there's any necessity for follow-up work in the fall, in the spring, that a second letter would be submitted at that point. If that helps.
Which we're already stating, and I'm just trying to think ahead. If the letter is submitted and it says that the applicant didn't follow the instructions, then we return to the point where we had a violation of wetlands or alteration again.
Mm-hmm.
And so, without being redundant, I think the only thing that needs to be added was the first part of your suggestion the requirements of the Soil and Water Conservation District letter be followed by the applicant, and the applicant shall submit a letter from.
I think that's what I was trying to suggest.
Okay.
Any further comment from the board?
I don't know, but maybe our scribe could read back. Yes, that's for you.
As in town planner, would you be so kind?
Okay. My understanding is that there, I think what we've done is dropped the condition three in favor of an expanded condition one, so I'll try with that.
Mm-hmm.
The first condition, that the applicant comply with the suggestions in the July 29th and September 10th letter from the Cumberland County Soil and Water Conservation District, and that after the work is completed this fall, the applicant shall submit a letter from the Cumberland County Soil and Water Conservation District to the code enforcement officer upon completion of work this fall and any follow-up deemed necessary by the district next spring. And then I think the second condition is that because the applicant has elected not to install cabling conduit, then any further maintenance or replacement of the electrical line shall be located outside the trench in accordance with the zoning ordinance.
In effect at the time.
In effect at the time.
Should that possibly say outside of the wetland?
I think what you just say in accordance with regulations.
Yeah, in accordance, because it may be in 20 years, it may be hard to do it in the wetlands. Who knows?
It's actually all right to do it now.
As long as it's permitted, that's
mm-hmm.
correct.
Mm-hmm.
And so, is that correct? Or
well, then are we saying a condition is that any future change would require change from what is currently acceptable?
I just want it on the record. I don't want to have this someone digging another trench. It's whatever is in effect at the time, the maintenance or new work would need to take place would be fine with me. I don't necessarily think we need to stipulate that it has to be outside the trench if it, in fact, doesn't have to be.
Well, that was my point. That the amended motion was to say that it had to be outside of the wetlands when the current zoning ordinance doesn't say it has to be. It simply has to be permitted. We have to have a wetlands alteration permit to do so. the intent is to make sure that the applicant, should any change in the future, the applicant would be required to come back through the alterations permit process. Is that what we're saying?
That's correct. Whatever
That's correct.
Process is in effect at the time.
So do you want to eliminate the language located outside
that's
the trench?
That's
yes.
right.
I think
we just
yes.
make
eliminate
it make it in accordance with
yeah.
the
okay. My, so my understanding is condition two would be because the applicant has elected not to install cable and conduit, any further maintenance or replacement shall be in accordance with the zoning ordinance in effect at that time.
Mm-hmm. So be it.
And you've now dropped condition three, which referenced how fill would be removed from Sunrise Drive, since it's now referenced in the letters from Ross Cutlitz.
Is that correct, Ms. Larkin?
The way it would be done is specified in the letter. We might need a specific condition to state that it does need to be removed. I'm not sure. I wouldn't want there to be any discrepancy. I'm concerned, since we don't know the ownership, I feel like if they put it back as best they can, then it becomes a civil issue if some owner is upset with them. I want that clear. Is that a problem?
I think as long as that's what we're doing, is making it very clear that that's intent. However, whatever. I don't have the letters in front of me, so I don't know what is included.
What the September 10th letter is talking about is, it's assuming that that would be done, and it says remove the excessive tote road gravel is best done by, and then it tells how it should be done.
I think that's clear enough. So if we follow that, if you want to add more verbiage, either to something existing, to what is I think our first condition, or make it a third condition.
Perhaps we could say in the first condition that as a clause after the compliance with the two Soil Conservation Service letters, you could just insert, in order to restore the disturbed areas to their as closely as possible to the state that they were in prior to the trenching.
Judy, does that answer you?
I think so.
Okay.
Any other comments from any other board members? Are we all clear about what the findings of fact and the order with the two conditions is? Okay.
I'd like to hear one more time from the scribe.
Condition one would be that the applicant comply with the suggestions in the July 29th and September 10th letter from the Cumberland County Soil and Water Conservation District, and that the work that the recommendation, okay, let's start that again. That the applicant comply with the suggestions in the Cumberland County Soil and Water Conservation District's letter of July 29th and September 10th, and that after the work is completed this fall, the applicant shall submit it, this fall, comma, in order to restore the disturbed areas to the state prior to the trenching, comma, the applicant shall also submit a letter from the Cumberland County Soil and Water Conservation District to the code enforcement officer upon completion work and upon any follow-up deemed necessary by the district next spring. Second condition being, because the applicant has elected not to install cable and conduit, that any further maintenance or replacement shall be in accordance with the zoning ordinance in effect at that time.
Any further discussion, Ms. Larden?
I just wanted to ask Mr. Edsel if he would consider putting in the third finding of fact again, which was the installation of conduit around the utility lines would decrease the necessity of disturbing the wetland in the future for maintenance purposes.
I guess I had avoided it because I wasn't sure that it was a fact. I'm just not sure that simply because you install conduit, there's any guarantee of future disturbing the wetlands. That was why I left it out.
I would just ask if you would do that, and up to you.
You might even say will likely decrease, so you won't have to make the statement wholly.
Would like.
I would agree as but may.
One last question, if I might. How long does the, if they had gone about this in the normal order of things, how long does it take them to get a wetlands alteration permit?
How blue is the sky?
you want to take a crack at that, Maureen?
With the exception of one applicant, I believe everyone else who's asked for a wetlands alteration permit is done in conjunction with another type of review. But the ordinance requires that you submit an application and that it must be deemed complete and that a public hearing shall be held, so there's a minimum of two meetings involved.
Okay, so then if they have some sort of emergency with their power, something's happened to their power, and they cannot get to the lines without getting a wetlands alteration permit without power until such time as they do?
Or they find an alternative location to locate power supply that's not in a wetland area.
Could I be very retentive just for a minute?
Just this once, Mr.
This is a lesson in not being a single item agenda on an emergency session, special meeting. I think Judy was trying to get to the issue of the filling of the road, and that's been sort of watered down by talking about trenching. I think it should be, you've mentioned trenching, but you haven't mentioned filling. You need to say disturbances caused by the trenching and filling, or I think the word filling should be added to trenching.
I agree.
Otherwise, one reading the condition would simply assume that it only meant the trenched areas, not the roadways.
Mm-hmm. Are we clear now that there are, I'm sorry, I believe that Mr. Edsel accepted the insertion of item number 3 on the findings of fact that the installation of the conduit around the utility lines may decrease the necessity. Renumbering then old items 3 and 4 to be renumbered 4 and 5. Any further discussion on this matter? Anybody need to have the motion read one more time? All in favor of the motion as stated, raise your right hand. All opposed? Mr. Parkhurst dissenting? Thank you. Dr. Gramsci, do you have any questions about what the board decision has meant, or any questions about the language in the Soil Conservation Service letters, or what you required of the neighbors?
I don't think so. I think basically we plan to do what's been submitted and what you've asked us to do, and we will endeavor to do that and do it as quickly as possible. I would like to thank the board on behalf of myself and my neighbors. I know that this is a special meeting, and we appreciate that your timely attention to this matter, and we hope to get it done as soon as possible. Thank you.
Thank you. The special meeting is now. Do we have to have a motion for adjournment?
Second.
Mr. Parker seconded. All in favor? Unanimous. Thank you.